dreamt last night the moon was so bright it melted the walls away. And it wasn't alarming when I saw Prince Charming come into my bedroom and say,
let me persuade you to come to the place where tomorrow meets today.
Ooh!
Bigger and better cities with gadgets.
Forward progress. If you were a scientist, you were in.
Building a new world. 35 years ago, one man set out to turn this country into a modern industrial utopia. He was Kwame Nkrumah, the first leader of a newly independent black African state. His aim was to transform Ghana into a society shaped and driven by the power of science.
And I see and hear springing up cities of Ghana, becoming the metropolis of science, learning, scientific agriculture, and philosophy. Seek ye first the political kingdom, and all other things shall be added unto it.
We are then the nation for our home. We supply power to every home.
At the heart of Nkrumah's plan was a giant dam that would produce vast quantities of cheap electricity. Enough power to build a modern industrial state in the heart of Africa within a generation. But what Nkrumah did not foresee was that with the dam would come other, more dangerous forms of power which he could not control. Political and economic forces that would tear apart his vision of using science and technology to create a model for the new Africa.
Nkrumah was, in my mind, a visionary, not a dreamer. In his mind's eye, he could see United States of Africa as the United States of America, and he could see Africa coming together to form a viable unit. To become a world power in the shortest possible time.
From now on, there is a new African in the world.
He needed power, and there was no source from which he could get the amount of power which he needed. And this was the one source which could provide him with that power. And he was prepared to go the whole length to get it.
We begin in West Africa, one of the two great areas of the world where we have ruled but never settled.
To the people of the Gold Coast, there came last week a day that will always be remembered in their history. For here, in what's been a British colony for more than a century, nearly a million people went to the polls in their first general election. The main issue in the election lay between those who want self-government sometime in the future and those who want it now, like the Convention People's Party, the CPP. Their leader, Kwame Nkrumah, spent election day in jail, serving a sentence for incitement and sedition.
Nkrumah's rise had been irresistible. After spending 10 years in America as a student, he had returned to the Gold Coast in 1947. Within 2 years, he had formed a political party. 2 years after that, he swept to power. Although the British still controlled trade, defence and foreign policy, he had become the first black African prime minister.
Nkrumah, before coming into power, has, in his election manifesto, had made certain promises about development, about turning the country into a modern industrial country. Nkrumah very much believed that for development, power was necessary, that you had to have power, that without power, you couldn't develop.
Power meant electricity, and the source was to be the giant Volta River that flowed through the eastern half of the country. Ever since the 1920s, the British had planned to build a dam there. A hydroelectric plant would produce electricity to make aluminium from the Gold Coast's vast reserves of the mineral bauxite. In the early 50s, Britain was desperate for a cheap source of aluminium, and Nkrumah joined with the British to resuscitate the scheme.
This is the Volta, the greatest natural resource of the Gold Coast, whose latent power is the mainspring of the most visionary development project in the whole of Africa. And this is bauxite, which lies in millions of tons beneath the green forested hills of the Gold Coast. From this red earth, man can extract the shining wonder metal of today, aluminium. And that is the aim of the Gold Coast, to cap the march to independence with a dramatic leap into the age of technology.
The British authorities saw the power from the dam simply as a means to boost the empire's supply of aluminium. But for Nkrumah, it was much more. He saw it as the key to fulfilling his country's destiny.
The power was originally conceived just for the manufacture of aluminium in this country. But then when Kwame came, he gave a new accent, a new importance to that power project. That was, the power was to be used for a comprehensive economic development of the country.
Together, Nkrumah and the British organised a travelling exhibition to promote the Volta scheme. Large models of the dam were built and taken round the country amidst a blaze of publicity. The exhibition was seen by nearly 2 million people.
Some elderly folks, their reaction was first, is it possible, is it feasible for this to happen in their lifetime? And I remember in one particular place, there was one farmer who came in the cloth and did ask the question, what can he do to help for the project to come on?
The two mobile cinemas ranged the country ahead, showing films to audiences large and small, wherever they could find them, showing how great rivers can create prosperity for the people who live beside them.
The exhibition was a great success, and it helped Nkrumah consolidate his political position. But to his opponents, whom he had defeated in the election, the Volta scheme was a dangerous trap, just another cycle in the British exploitation of their country.
The British people were anxious to give us that scheme. And one thing I must make clear, the scheme was not started by Nkrumah. The Volta River scheme was an old scheme of a British government.
In 1953, Nkrumah's opponents forced a debate in Parliament. In a series of speeches, the opposition MPs warned that Nkrumah was in danger of enslaving the country to powerful interests far beyond his control.
As a long-term scheme, it is excellent. But as a short-term scheme, Mr. Speaker, it is suicidal. I would say that no nation which is beginning to free itself puts its neck in a position in which it will find itself in economic slavery.
At the end of the debate, Nkrumah defended his partnership with the British. We are not boys, he said. Do you think I am a fool to enter into a project like this blindly? I am not so damn silly as to put my nose into something that is detrimental to this country.
All my life, I've been a man of peace, working for peace, striving for peace, negotiating for peace. But I'm utterly convinced that the action we have taken is right.
In 1956, Britain invaded Egypt to prevent President Nasser from nationalizing the Suez Canal. Within 10 days, the United Nations and the Americans forced them to retreat. Suez symbolized the decline of Britain's colonial power. Vast projects like the Volta Dam began to look increasingly insecure in the face of confident new African leaders. And Britain was running out of money. That same year, Nkrumah's government was told the Volta scheme was shelved.
Nkrumah had received the news that the British government intended to pull out of the scheme because The finances were getting too large for them to handle.
He was almost in despair. Everybody was depressed. All of those of us who were involved in it in any way were shattered when we discovered that the project was on the shelf. And Nkrumah, but Nkrumah was not a man to allow depression to take over.
On the 6th of March 1957, the Gold Coast became Ghana, the first black African country to be free.
Ghana, your beloved country, is free forever. We are going to demonstrate to the world, to the other nations, young as we are, that we are prepared to lay our own foundation.
Out of the darkness, the pledge and the promise.
The promise of independence was not just going to be just freedom, but that people will see it in their lives. A promise that we are going to industrialize the country as a means of generating growth, economic growth. And industrialization means that we must have power. And therefore, the first thing was that all of us should harness all our resources to get the power established.
It was a glorious moment for Ghana and for Nkrumah. But in private, he knew that many of the promises on which he had been swept to power might prove dangerously hollow if the dam were not built. It was the key to his vision of leading Africa into a shining tomorrow.
Freedom! Freedom! Freedom!
But then, 4,000 miles away, a simple twist of fate brought the Volta scheme back to life. At the end of 1957, Nkrumah's finance minister, Komla Bedema, went to America on a private visit.
I was invited to Maryland State College to give a talk on the newly independent Ghana. And as I was driving there from New York, I felt like having a drink of orange juice or water at a roadside restaurant, Howard Johnson's restaurant in Delaware. My secretary, who was an American, a black American, told me, "Minister, I think this is one of the states where they are very sticky about color." I said, "What?"
The home of good, good food is Howard Johnson's.
Howard Johnson's is such a friendly place to have good food.
I asked for two glasses of orange juice. The girl looked at us, said, "No, sir, you can't." I said, "What? You can't." Then she turned away, went in and told the manager to come and speak to us. So the manager came and said, "Gentlemen, I'm sorry, because of your color, you can't drink in here." And I said to him, "Look, there are people here who are lower social status than I am, but they can drink and I can't. Okay, you can keep the orange juice and the change, but you haven't heard the last of this." Next morning, it was world news all over the world.
Well, during the call for breakfast with the president, he wanted to know how it all happened, so I told him...
During breakfast, he asked me, "What were you doing in the United States?" I said, "I've come here to talk about the Volta project." "How's that project?" he asked. I said, "Well, we've put it in cold storage because we can't find the money immediately." "Have you talked to the State Department?" he said. "No, we haven't." "Dick, Richard, will you take care of that?" And that was how the Volta project came back to life so soon.
Nkrumah seized the opportunity. He wrote to Eisenhower asking for help in building the dam. Eisenhower invited him to visit America. At their meeting in March 1958, he told Nkrumah that the best way to get the scheme started again would be to involve American industry.
The Kaiser Aluminum Hour.
Eisenhower contacted Edgar Kaiser. He was head of one of the largest aluminium corporations in the world.
Kaiser Aluminum, the bright star of metal.
Kaiser was based in Oakland, California. It had mines and smelting plants throughout the world. It promoted aluminium as the shining, lightweight metal of the future.
Presenting Aluminum,
in a demonstration of those remarkable properties that have made it the favorite of millions. Aluminum is famed for its lightness.
At Eisenhower's request, Edgar Kaiser flew from California to meet Nkrumah in New York.
We were staying at the Waldorf Towers, and Edgar came in, and he and Nkrumah stood and looked at each other, and some kind of magnetic quality passed between them. It was quite remarkable. They took to each other at once. And I doubt if that electricity ever evaporated throughout their experience, although they had many set twos in one way or another.
Today, Ghana is a land of the future. Accra's international airport serves the major airlines.
At the end of 1958, a team of Kaiser executives and engineers flew to Accra to look at the plans for the scheme.
And at the end of the journey, a modern city.
Welcoming Nkrumah offered the Kaiser team a deal. If they agreed to build an aluminium smelter in Ghana, then his government would be able to raise the money for the dam. In return, the dam would supply the large quantities of electricity needed by the plant. The rest would go to power the future industries of the new Ghana. To the Kaiser team, Ghana seemed an attractive prospect.
It was wealthy. I think they had $400 million in the bank. Very highly educated. Every driver was reading the newspaper. I mean, they were very literate people. And it was as good a place to try in Africa as you could go to.
They were aggressive. There was one young lawyer who impressed me, who became great friends, Ron Sullivan. He was very aggressive, and they were later on got to understand what they were doing. That was their nature. Unlike the British, who were very gentlemanly, the Americans were straight to the point and no frills or wrapping up the... They call a spade, and a shovel a shovel.
They wanted the dam. And we were the means to get it, because we were the way that the dam was being financed.
It had always been assumed by the Ghanaians that, as with the British scheme, the smelter would use the vast reserves at their own bauxite, and so create an important new industry. But in the middle of the negotiations, the Kaiser team made it clear they had no intention of using Ghana's bauxite for the time being. Instead, they would import the raw materials needed by the smelter from America. The decision shocked the Ghanaian negotiating team.
They might have been disappointed, but you have to realize that wasn't that high grade of bauxite. It was high 30s or low 40s. And the bauxite, for example, over in Guinea was 55%. Makes a lot of difference in cost. It just wasn't possible at that time.
This seemed to be totally wrong to Nkrumah. He was intensely upset. He could never believe that Ghana's bauxite couldn't be converted by a series of processes into pots and pans and roofing sheets.
What the Kaiser executives didn't tell the Ghanaians was that there was another reason why they didn't want to use the local bauxite.
We were greatly concerned that if we located within Ghana all of the bauxite and power necessary to have an integrated aluminum operation, that someday our project, if it were profitable, might be nationalized by the government and taken away from us.
The Kaiser team refused to change their minds. They knew, as well as Nkrumah did, that without them, there would be no dam. At the end of 1959, Nkrumah told his team to agree to Kaiser's terms. Millions of dollars worth of Ghanaian bauxite would remain in the ground. But with Kaiser's letter of intent in his pocket, Nkrumah knew he could now set about raising the money to build the dam. He approached the World Bank. It had been set up at the end of the war to provide loans to rebuild Europe, but now it had turned its attention to the Third World. He asked the bank for £30 million. It was the largest loan ever requested. Yet the bank's economists believed, as Nkrumah did, that electricity was the key to industrial development in the Third World.
We envisage the development of this power resource as fundamental to Ghanaian economic development. The provision of power, electric power, to Ghana was an immense economic benefit to the country, was a sine qua non of economic development in the country. So let's accept that the economic benefits for power to Ghana were tremendous.
The belief that science and technology applied on a grand scale would somehow inevitably propel a third world country into the industrial age was the prevailing wisdom of the time. It was called the theory of takeoff. It gripped the imagination of politicians and economists both in the West and in the third world. In June 1960, the World Bank approved the scheme in principle, but its report had important reservations. The most serious concerned the price Kaiser paid Ghana for electricity. The World Bank made it clear that if Nkrumah was to get the benefits he expected from the dam, he must negotiate a certain minimum rate for the power. If he didn't, Ghana might find it difficult to take off.
Our report essentially was saying to Ghana, this project will succeed and we're prepared to make a loan on it, and the loan can be paid out if the power price is right. This was absolutely the key to the negotiations.
As a conductor of electricity, it's hard to beat.
But Kaiser needed a low rate if the smelter was to be profitable. A second round of negotiations began.
In toughness and adaptability, it can be made as strong as structural steel.
Nkrumah faced a terrible dilemma. His advisors and the World Bank told him that if he accepted the price Kaiser was offering, the high expectations he had of the dam might not be realized. But if he refused, Nkrumah knew that Kaiser would pull out and the dam would never be built.
Nkrumah was a man besieged. He had to do something. As you know, he had raised up hopes of the development of the country, that the Volta River project would turn Ghana into a modern industrial country. He had no other program. Insofar as he saw it as providing this minimum of the power which he saw, he was prepared to go along.
The negotiations dragged on through the autumn of 1960. Neither side would give way on the electricity price. Finally, one hot afternoon in December, Edgar Kaiser decided to confront Nkrumah and force the issue.
Kaiser asked for the meeting to be adjourned and went straight to Nkrumah and explained that perhaps his shareholders would not go along with the project if we asked for a higher power rate than Kaiser was asking for. A message came back after lunch, direct from Nkrumah, that we're to go ahead and accept the rate. He wanted the project at all costs.
Kwame Nkrumah and Edgar Kaiser, on the 22nd of January, 1962, signed the master agreement, which enfolded every provision that was necessary between Edgar Kaiser's company and the Ghana government. When they had signed it, they stood up and clasped each other in a very, very genuine embrace. I was there together with a large number of other distinguished guests, and I don't think any of us will ever forget it. The following day, we all went to Akosombo, and Nkrumah let off a vast charge, and the scheme started.
Yes, I suppose you can say Kaiser used Nkrumah. But if that makes Nkrumah passive, that would be inaccurate. Because Nkrumah also used Kaiser. The question is, whose end of the bargain came out better? Nkrumah would seem to have been going into an area with so many unknowns. One can say that while he was pursuing power, power slipped through his fingers.
But even as Nkrumah and Edgar Kaiser celebrated, other forces were becoming involved in the scheme. The dam was now a hostage in the vicious confrontations of the Cold War. A year before, the Congo had been torn apart by a brutal civil war. America and the Soviet Union backed opposite sides. The policy of the new Kennedy administration was to fight the spread of communism in Africa. In 1960, Brezhnev, the president of the Soviet Union, had visited Ghana. it frightened America's leaders. They were determined that Nkrumah, despite his brand of African socialism, would be their man.
Nkrumah was everything. He was everything, politically, economically, psychologically, culturally, and so on. He just absolutely dominated the scene.
Nkrumah, though, wanted to keep Ghana and Africa out of the Cold War.
President and distant delegates, it's quite clear that a desperate attempt is being made to create confusion in the Congo, extend the Cold War to Africa, and involve Africa in the suicidal quarrels of foreign powers. The United Nations must not allow this to happen.
But there was the dam. The American government realized that it was a powerful weapon with which to ensnare Nkrumah. Like the World Bank, the Kennedy administration had agreed to lend millions of dollars to the scheme. In an internal memorandum, the Secretary of State, Dean Rusk, made it quite clear what this money was for. By maintaining this leverage on Nkrumah, he wrote, the US will be in a better position to influence his policies. In public, though, it was called foreign aid.
The problem was that we foresaw that the progress that the Soviets were making and extending their communist ideology, particularly in Africa and to some extent in South America, certainly in the Middle East, and that therefore we had to counter that some way. And we countered it with foreign aid as a defense against the spread of communism.
Bit by bit, Nkrumah's utopian vision was slipping away. The Volta scheme had become something very different from what he had originally intended. At every stage, the project had been shaped not by his idealism, but by powerful political and economic pressures. But Nkrumah still believed it was worthwhile, because once the dam was built, it could not be taken away. In time, it would become the engine of his country's future.
Everyone was hopeful. Those absolutely were optimistic times for hope. Ghana was singular in the sense that it had everything. It had educated people. It had considerable infrastructure, three universities, schools, lawyers, doctors. It had everything going for it.
The construction of the dam was to take 4 years. Throughout Ghana, factories and roads began to be built, the foundations of the industrial revolution that would be powered by the dam. But with these trappings of the modern world came other forces that took Ghana's fragile economy even further from Nkrumah's control.
Corruption is not a problem peculiar to any country. I personally feel that the only way in which you can stop corruption in any country is to build up a strong public opinion against it.
Elements entered into the equation that had not been adequately foreseen, and perhaps the greatest of them was corruption. Corruption of government and of government people, and corruption, I call it corruption, on the part of foreign suppliers who tried to sell Ghana, in fact did sell Ghana, on investment in substantial industrial enterprises which were not properly designed for the country and did not, in fact, achieve success.
In the early 60s, Ghana became a mecca for European industrialists eager to win large contracts from Nkrumah's government. They began to discover that the easiest way was to offer officials from Nkrumah's party a bribe. This soon became the accepted way of doing business in Accra. What resulted was a rush to sell Ghana anything, no matter how inappropriate for an emerging African nation. Vast sums of Ghana's precious foreign currency were spent on these projects. Then, in 1964, Nkrumah's industrial experiment received another body blow. The world price of cocoa, which had been falling for 4 years, finally crashed. It was Ghana's main source of foreign exchange. The millions of pounds needed to pay for the new factories began to dry up. Ghana, once one of the richest countries in Africa, began to slide into debt.
Show me the river, take me across, and wash all my troubles away.
Nkrumah was an increasingly isolated figure on the world stage. What had once been seen as visionary ideas were now perceived as dangerous megalomania. And his country was sinking ever deeper into debt.
By 1965, it had become very desperate. And I remember we decided to write a memorandum to Nkrumah to tell him the true state of affairs of the economy. I had written that the reserves were only £500,000. He looked at me and said, you didn't check the typing. You left a few zeros. So I said, no, sir, there are no zeros left. This is 500,000. That's all we have in the banks overseas. And he sat back. Then what he did was that he went around the table. He went to everyone who was seated there, the meeting, and asked them, Frimpong says we have 500,000. Is he right? Do you agree with him? And everybody said yes. That was the first time the whole cabinet acknowledged to the president that Ghana was bankrupt.
A river, take me across and wash all my troubles away. Like the lucky old sun, give me nothing to do.
Is African Union now. There is no time to waste. We must unite or we perish. I am confident that by our concerted effort and determination...
Kwame Nkrumah was losing both domestically and internationally in his posture. He was practically alone in Flagstaff House. He was really a little bit paranoid. It was really awfully sad. He was even afraid to, I remember they opened their parliament one day and Nkrumah didn't want to take the chance to drive from Flagstaff House to the parliament building. He was a prisoner in a sense. There had been a couple of attempts on his life while we were there. So he had reason to be a little bit apprehensive, but toward the end, he was a different person.
On the 22nd of January 1966, the dam was finally finished. Nkrumah organized a massive celebration. He invited the whole country to attend.
The mood of the people at the celebration, the mood of the country was euphoric. There was this vast project which had come in, and they understood it will have a tremendous impact and effect on the country. I felt euphoric. I was quite enthusiastic. I thought a new dawn had come for Ghana.
But all that was happening against a background of a country that already had no money. It had exchange controls, import controls. So it was just like a big emperor's new clothes. Nobody could say that Ghana was broke, but Ghana really was broke.
President Eisenhower and President Kennedy were genuinely interested in this project because they saw behind the cold figures and the rigid calculations that the Volta River project was not only an economically viable project, but also an opportunity for the United States of America to make a purposeful capital investment in a developing country. You see before you, in all his majesty, strength and power, the Akosombo Dam, which has tamed the turbulent waters of the Volta.
A lot of us, myself particularly, did not take our seats at the official seating place and watch the ceremony from further uphill. Many, many reasons for that. One of them was that there was talk of possible coup at the time.
This is Ghana's Volta River project, a project that is to lead Ghana to a new, brighter, and a more prosperous future.
Citizens of Ghana and fellow countrymen, good evening. The Ghana Armed Forces took over the reins of government of this country after a successful overthrow of the regime of Kwame Nkrumah in what may be truly described as one of the boldest ventures in the history of this country.
Hello, fans. Excuse the bristling about with weapons and the flushing in the face, but I've just come from dashing away from it, doing a bit of liberating. And overthrowing the government and all that business. Overthrowing the government is rather heavy going at the best of times, but my goodness, folks, this is a landmine in the history of Africa, no mistake.
The military coup won enormous popular support. Nkrumah had failed to deliver the modern Ghana he had promised. The dam had come too late to save him. But there were other forces involved in planning the coup. America, too, had finally lost patience with Nkrumah.
Well, Howard Bain, who was the CIA station chief in Accra, engineered the overthrow of Kwame Nkrumah. Now, obviously, you can look at it different ways. A Ghanaian might say, I thought we did it. Inside the CIA, though, it was quite clear Howard Bain got a double promotion and the intelligence star for having overthrown Kwame Nkrumah in Ghana. The magic of it, what made it so exciting to the CIA, was that Howard Bain had had enough imagination and drive to run the operation without ever documenting what he was doing, and to sweep along his bosses in such a way they knew what he was doing, tacitly they approved, but there wasn't one shred of paper that he generated that would nail the CIA hierarchy as being responsible.
Nkrumah fled to Guinea and never returned to Ghana. He died in 1972. In the 1950s, in the eyes of the West, his country had been a radiant model for what Africa was to become. But by the time he fell, that image had been replaced by a picture of a continent racked by military coups and corruption. In the late 60s, Western journalists travelled to Ghana to pick over the bones of his industrial experiment. Their contemptuous reports seemed to confirm to the West a new myth of Africa, a continent unable to handle the complex pressures of industrialization.
Kwame Nkrumah, the communist messiah of Africa, came home in 1947 with the clothes he stood up in and a cardboard suitcase. He left 19 years later, a multimillionaire. He turned a £250 million credit at independence to a £600 million debt, and he left Accra studded with expensive white elephants, such as this massive saluting base here in Black Star Square.
Today, Black Star Square, built by Nkrumah for mass parades to demonstrate enthusiasm for his rule, remains as a bleak reminder of his conceit.
Overlooking the square was Job 600, built by Nkrumah specially for the OAU conference in 1965. It's never been used since.
This luxury block was to house the Pan-African Congress. They never came.
There was the Accra-Tema motorway, cost £6 million to duplicate a fast good road already in existence. They say the Russians actually managed to sell snow plows to this state in equatorial Africa.
For Ghana, the years following Nkrumah's fall were ones of economic failure. The dam worked well, but the industrial world that was to have sprung up around it failed to materialize. Those Ghanaians who had been moved to make way for the dam found themselves stranded in the wreckage of Nkrumah's dream.
I become quite disgusted because we are directly about 3 miles from the Volta Dam. But we don't have power. No electricity, no water. So my feeling is that when we have these things, we can do so much to help the nation.
Valco, the Volta Aluminium Company, owned and run by the Kaiser Corporation, flourished. It employed over 1,500 Ghanaians and brought precious foreign exchange into the country. It used most of the dam's electricity and so allowed the World Bank loan to be paid off without interruption. The smelter became an integral part of Kaiser's worldwide production of aluminium.
In a way, we looked at this as a gigantic dry cleaning plant. What we did was we sent alumina from the United States to the smelter. The smelter put electricity through it and took out the oxygen, and that made metal.
In the 1970s, electricity prices soared throughout the world. Although the Ghanaians periodically renegotiated the price Kaiser paid, it remained one of the lowest rates anywhere. This caused increasing resentment. Then, in 1979, there was another military coup, the seventh since Nkrumah fell. It was led by a flight lieutenant in the Air Force. He was determined to put Ghana back on its feet.
I must share this fact with you, that Ghana has no money. We cannot build a bridge or make a road or give our people water or medicines without borrowing from other countries. We have borrowed so much that for every 100 pounds we earn by selling our cocoa and other exports, we use a sizable proportion, percentage, to pay for some of our debts. We cannot continue to borrow and be in debt all the time.
Rawlings became a popular figure, on a par with Nkrumah. His main aim was to lift the burden of debt, and one of the most obvious solutions was to get more money from the smelter. In 1983, his government put together a team. Its task was to persuade Kaiser to renegotiate the agreement signed with Nkrumah.
The new government decided to take the bull by the horns and confront Kaiser directly. A number of things made them sit up and listen. I think they were aware at all times that the new government in power was quite prepared to take drastic measures, if necessary, to achieve the objective of a new agreement. They must have thought us a bit of a joke. I recall the first day when we met, when we had a lecture from Kaiser about how to compose a team. We were too many in the room, for instance. And I said, well, you choose your team, we will choose our team. We were young, green, and inexperienced, and I think they underrated us.
Valco's management agreed to meet the Ghanaians, but the talk soon became bogged down in disagreement. The Ghanaian team decided to raise the stakes.
Then we started to play our master plan. We decided that we were going to nationalize. We knew that we wouldn't do it, but we wanted to put it strongly and send up a paper to government for permission to do that. We knew that it would leak out and Kaiser would get the message. Of course, we had another advantage, that was the dam was shut down because of the low level, and we had to decide when to open, and we wouldn't open until we had got a good deal.
So Kaiser would be left?
With a smelter that was sitting down doing nothing, and they would be losing money.
Although Kaiser denied that the ploy worked, a completely new agreement was negotiated and signed in January 1985. As part of it, the price Kaiser paid for electricity from the dam was increased by nearly three times. The Ghanaian people saw it as a victory for their country.
Whereas transform the country, experience has shown that it requires a good deal more than that. It requires a political environment. It requires a whole range of international understandings to make it possible to transform the potential which science presents into actual achievement. And regrettably, Ghana was not able to draw upon these other elements to make its vision of science and technology in the driving seat realizable.
So it is true that one needs political power. One needs knowledge that is also power. And then one has to combine that with the energy, the electrical power, for us to get to that paradise.
Rimbui, 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 rimbui.